Out. Good morning. This is BBC Tees. Mike Parr with you. Now, whilst Diana Ross was playing there, I've moved downstairs into the BBC Tees reception area, and we're going to talk in some detail about loneliness. We've been talking about this quite a bit on BBC Tees this week. A recent survey commissioned by the BBC came up with a startling finding that more people in the Northeast feel lonely than any other part of the country. Now, that surprised me. I don't know about you. So if that is the case, what can be done about it? So a special debate here on BBC Tees this morning, and we want to hear from you as well, your experiences of feeling isolated and lonely. What is the main thing that can be done to help people in that situation? The number is 01642 225511. If you'd rather text me, that's absolutely fine. 81333, start your message with the word Tees. Well, somebody who has had first-hand experience of loneliness and has tried to do something about it is Pat Large from Stockton. Pat, good morning to you. From Thornaby, I've moved you.
Thank you.
This problem for you started then with the death of your husband, did it?
Yes.
So tell me what happened.
Well, when he was very ill, he encouraged me to take more part in council life and things like that. And I stood for council and I was elected, and he lived till the day that I was elected. But from there, even with the council work, I found there was a big void. The loneliness was absolutely horrific.
And can you put that into words then, how it actually feels?
There's nothing there. There's nobody there. After 40-odd year, you're just going into an empty house. You'd expect them to be sat there. You'd expect them to answer you back. And you talk to yourself in the back kitchen. And it's horrific. It really is. And I thought, I've got to do something about this. So I inquired around, not as a counsellor, but it did help. And we ended up in the Youthy on Thornaby Road, and we started a little group up. It started with three or four people. It built up. Then we got to about 20, and we were doing little raffles, things what you would use every day, not boxes of chocolates or anything like that. It was like a breakfast hamper or thing. At fivepence or tenpence a ticket, that just to cover the thing. And a little bit extra went into the pot so we could have a day out.
And was it the routine then? Was it giving yourself something to do and meeting and talking with other people that drew you out of it?
Yeah. It was good for me because I was meeting people I might have known years ago, and I was meeting people that were coming out of their homes to be with other people. They become friends. They went to other places together. They went to each other's homes for a cup of tea. Don't be afraid to give a neighbour a cup of tea. We know in this day and age you're a bit wary, but if they're of your age group and they're on their own, please go and give them, just have a cup of tea with them, anything. And if they're infirm and they want something, go to the shop for them while you're going for yourself.
Well, we got Kate Jopling with us as well from the campaign to end loneliness. You are the director and you've made the journey up from London to be with us this morning. How typical is that story?
Unfortunately, I think the experience of loneliness is really common, and the experience of loneliness as a daily grind that really does get you down is what is a real issue of concern, because that isn't just sad and it isn't just upsetting. It's actually something that seriously damages our health. It impacts not just on our mental health, which I think people understand, but also on our physical health. So it's something that's really important to do something about. And it's amazing when people like Pat can actually take their own steps to do something about it. But for a lot of people, they need the extra support. They need the support of a group like Pat created that will give them somewhere to be, give them a place that's safe, that they feel able to come out and start socialising again. And then over time, as she's seen, people build their own networks up, and that's what really supports them, and that's what stops the loneliness in the longer term.
Yeah, this is really serious, isn't it? Because we now hear this research from America says that long-term exposure to loneliness is a greater danger to our health than obesity.
Yeah, it's been calculated that it's an equivalent risk to health as smoking 15 cigarettes a day.
This is astonishing.
No one would underestimate 15 cigarettes a day, that's bad for your health. But loneliness is that bad. It's linked to cardiovascular disease, it's linked to dementia, it's linked to emergency admission to hospital, going into a care home more quickly than otherwise. So it's absolutely serious, and it gets right to the heart of some of the things we're most worried about in terms of cost to the health service, cost to social care.
I bet that comes as no surprise to you, does it?
No, it doesn't. Not a bit. But anything at all you can do to help somebody who's on their own, please go and knock.
The question is, should councils, should the government be doing more about this then if it is such a serious problem?
Well, absolutely, I think they should. I think that what they need to be doing is planning for an ageing population, making sure that we've got in place all the things that help people stay connected. That's transport, that's good, accessible buildings, that's things that people want to do. But also recognising that for some people, loneliness grinds them down and they will need some support to come out of that. And that's where voluntary organisations and befriending schemes and mentoring schemes and buddying schemes and a whole range of different services come in, tailored to the individual to help them out this situation.
All right, we've got Sheila Clark who's got her hand up here. Now, Sheila is Cabinet Member for Health and Wellbeing from Redcar and Cleveland Council.
No, what Pat has described, the problem is massive, but the solution is simple. And what Pat's described is the solution. It has to come from the community, supported by the local authority, and then supported by the government. I don't know whether you...
So what happens at Redcar then?
Well, we got a silver award, didn't we, Kate? Because health and wellbeing is at the heart of everything we do. And we have an ageing better corporate improvement programme, and within that is the Community Health Fund, and I have a list of the £50,000 that's been allocated this year, and you would think it would be to projects that are corporate and by groups that are well set up. It isn't. It's by all sorts of little groups that are not big groups in the community. Whale Hill Community Association doing afternoon tea, East Cleveland Village Time Bank, Kids Against Bullying. It goes right across the whole thing, and this is what local authorities should be doing, and it's what we are doing.
But do we need to spend money on this? You know, do we need council tax money to be spent on these things?
Well, a lot of places you go to, if you want to set up a little group, they want £10 an hour or more, and then you've got tea and coffee. Yes. You can't afford it.
Yes, but you do need a place, and you know, sometimes places cost money, people charge for them, so that's the way we can give funding to
help. It's money well spent.
It is money very well spent, yes.
Okay, more chat on the way. Lots of hands going up here in BBC T's reception. It is 14 minutes to 11. And isn't it? With your travel news.
Thank you, Mike. Cargo Fleet and Sotheby Road. Between Queensway and Cargo Fleet Lane, there are temporary traffic lights for work going on there. It's water main work going on until the 4th of April. And Norton County Durham South Road, between Norton Road towards Ancroft Gardens, more temporary traffic lights. Work there until about 4 o'clock, 4:30 this afternoon. And again, it's water main work. And once again, there are temporary traffic lights. That's around the High Street and Ancroft Gardens. We're back with more in half an hour, but if you can update us in the meantime, do call 0800 854 833.
Keeping Teesside, County Durham and North Yorkshire
on the move.
BBC Tees.
Big pressure fights, there's no such thing for me. Just a chance to go out and enjoy myself on the biggest stage possible.
It's history in the making. The first ever world title fight featuring two Northeast boxers.
He's the one taking all the pressure. He's the one asking before.
BBC Tees is live and ringside. Darlington Stewart Hall goes toe-to-toe with County Durham's Martin Ward for the IBF World Bantamweight title.
Just perform on the night and become the new champion of the world.
The build-up starts this Saturday night from 9 on BBC Tees.
We're talking about loneliness. We're live in BBC T's reception this morning. Loneliness is a big problem in our part of the world, and this new American research tells us quite clearly it's a bigger risk to our health than obesity, which is shocking a lot of people this morning. Now, let's talk to Heather. Heather's here. Heather Black is from Together Middlesbrough. You got your hand up.
Yes. What I wanted to say was building on what Pat was talking about, setting up a local group in the community, because often we look at problems and think, what's the government going to do about this? What's the local council going to do about this? Often the solution is simple and it's rooted in local communities. Now, the job I do is working with churches across Middlesbrough tackling social issues. 60% of churches run drop-ins, lunch clubs, cafes where people can come and meet and get together and just begin to reduce that isolation.
This may sound a bit odd, but people that are lonely, do they necessarily want to join a group and be forced to mix with other people? Let's talk to Susan here. We've got Susan Carter, Deputy Chief Executive of Age UK Darlington.
I think the problem is that people we work with have been on their own for some considerable time, so it's actually building confidence and encouraging them to get out. And we have a number of lunch clubs that we encourage people to come to, but transport's a huge issue, because mostly we're looking at older women whose husbands have died, who are the drivers, and it's actually recruiting a number of volunteers who can actually take people where they need to go. But it's actually building somebody's confidence up. What we have found on our own befriending scheme is that after 6 months or so, the person is then willing to trust the person that's trying to encourage them to get out. They get them out and suddenly it's a new lease of life, and that person's whole outlook on life changes considerably and they're a new person.
So transport, put your hand up if you think transport is an issue. Yeah, every single hand has gone up. It is a common complaint that people simply cannot get out to meet friends or do things because there is no public transport. That can be a particular issue in our rural areas. Isaac is a teenager and lives in a remote area of County Durham. He says better transport links would help.
Good points would be that I've got plenty of space and I can pretty much do what I want when I want, really. And, yeah, as you say, it's really pretty. Bad points would be it's far away from everything. So we have a really long school day. We get on the bus at 8 and then get back about 4:20. So don't have much time in the evenings. More buses and stuff, there aren't many. Fewer days, hardly any.
Well, somebody who's got strong views on the issue of isolation is Councillor John Shuttleworth. John, good morning to you.
Hello, Mike. You all right?
Hello. Yes, I'm fine. You've been campaigning for better bus services in Weardale. What sort of services are there and can they be improved?
Well, where I live, there's only one bus at 11:30, which returns at 1:15. That's in Rookhope. If you go further up the valley, there was cuts made to the bus services a couple of years ago where the last bus, which goes up the valley, goes up at 6:45 and returns down at 7:30. And, you know, if you want to go anywhere after that, you're snookered. And there's very little taxi services as well, you know.
Right, so is there any chance of getting these services improved?
Well, I mean, they can equate it to government cuts or whatever, but it's creating social isolation, rural isolation. You know, I mean, where do you go? I mean, people need more services and, you know, they pay more council tax and they get less services.
Right, so if the bus services were more regular, do you think older people would use them?
I think so, yes. Yes, older people. It's more older people. If you go up during the day, you'll see more older people. You know, they're travelling here, there and everywhere. They go down to stand up for to go to the bank or whatever. It is something that's required, and if there was any more cuts, you know, it would seriously put... I think it would cause bigger problems.
Yeah, you also feel strongly about the rising charges for daycare centres as well.
Well, you see, if the daycare centres keep increasing, there's less people using them, and you know, before long the council say, well, it's not needed anymore. They take it away, and it'll create suicides, in my view.
All right, John, thank you very much. Good to talk to you. Councillor John Shuttleworth, then, who has been campaigning for better transport services for a long time, but as you've heard, they're not terribly frequent. OK, lots of hands going up then at this point. Back to you, Pat.
Thornaby Town Council puts a shuttle bus onto the route where they take the hours off, and it's been quite successful. They've just taken another bus off in Thornaby that we're looking into, see if we can afford to make it a circular bus. But with the funding and that, we don't know whether we can afford it.
Okay, and back to you, Susan.
There is an issue of older people and public transport, because a number of older people don't use public transport because there's no assistance. The bus doesn't stay still long enough for them to get to their seat. And that is a real issue for older people.
Let's talk next then to John Atkinson. Morning to you, John.
Good morning.
From the scheme Silver Talk. What happens at Silver Talk?
Silver Talk, we're a really simple idea. We phone people up and have a chat with them on a set day, set time. We make the call, so that all the cost is borne by ourselves. My job is to train up volunteers to facilitate that. And now we have hundreds of hours of people chatting to each other.
What do they talk about?
Everything. Kind of from day-to-day stuff, family, friends, pets, what they've done, their histories, their fantastic stories from childhood to kind of adulthood, growing up, everything you can imagine.
All right, we'll come back to that later, but transport is what we're dealing with at the moment then. So what's to be done?
I don't know what the answer is, but what I can tell you is lots of our older people are afraid. They've lost their confidence to get out there on a bus. That's a huge thing if you're 92, 93, you know, and a lady, you know, that is just a frightening prospect.
Bring it back to local councils and fund it properly. When it was deregulated, that's where all the problems came in. It wasn't before then. We need a proper local community bus service in every borough in the country, and it's got to be funded. Bring it back to local authorities and fund it. That's the answer to the transport problem.
I'll come to you in a moment, Susan. Speaking of which, we've got Bill Dixon on the line, who is leader of Darlington Council. Morning to you, Bill.
Hi, morning.
What are the chances, then, of the council improving bus services?
Remote, given the cuts that we've had. I think the previous speaker was dead right. If you think back to when Darlington had its own transport system, there were buses at all hours when people needed them. Early workers could get on buses to work. They ran till 11:30 at night. And we had the cheapest bus fares in the country. You know, deregulation completely wrecked it. All that happens now is these private companies run buses purely for profit, and if there's no profit in it, they will not run them without heavy subsidies. And we don't have the money to subsidise them anymore.
Right.
They keep the profits, we provide the subsidy. It's the economics of the madhouse.
Right, so you can't provide more subsidy then to make sure that older people have more services to use?
No. No, there's just no money. In the pot. It's as simple as that. I mean, what we have been able to do is assist in a thing called the Pink Bus in the west end of town, which has its own particular problems, and one in the rural area. But just going back to what Councillor Shuttleworth was saying, where these services still exist, it's vitally important that even if you're a car owner, now and again take the bus, because it won't be there when you need it. It's no good saying, well, you know, I don't need it at present. You know, for the sake of other people in your community, if you can, take the bus now and again and keep it viable.
Yeah, we've been hearing, Bill, you know, this research from America saying that long-term exposure to loneliness is worse for your health than obesity. Given that evidence, are councils starting to take isolation a bit more seriously?
Darling takes it very seriously. I mean, we've got the Good Friends scheme running, which has got over 600 volunteers since last October, which is phenomenal. So there is a real community spirit out there. There's a willingness for people to get involved and help. And yes, yeah, I agree. I worked in it was child mental health, but I worked in mental health services for nigh on 30 years, and I've seen the impact that loneliness can have, not just on the elderly, but anybody.
So what did you see, Bill?
In terms of rural isolation, it's absolutely terrible. It's not as bad in say, the Tees Valley in any of the big five boroughs. But in our rural area in Darlington, it's very easy to become so isolated. And as what your commentator said, you lose your confidence, then you don't go out. And not everybody, you know, can pop down the pub or join the club or whatever. You know, people need more community support, and I think that's what councils can do, and my council is doing it, thanks to help from people like Age Concern.
But you've seen the effect it can have on a human being when they're exposed to long-term loneliness.
Yeah, and it's not good.
It's serious.
We wouldn't want it for ourselves or our family, so why would we accept it in other people? You know, We do live in a civilised society, the sixth richest nation in the world. How come people can't get buses in our rural areas or even in our larger towns?
All right, Bill, thank you. Bill Dixon, the Labour leader of Darlington Council. Anybody want to comment on that then? Back to you, Susan.
I just, Bill's made reference to the Good Friends scheme that we actually run. We've got just short of 600 volunteers and they're doing low-level volunteering, or low-level support. It's about good neighbourliness. It's about encouraging people in the street or in the road to look out for that older person who may need just a little bit of help. It may be a cup of tea, it may be a plate of food, it may be to take them shopping, it may be to take them to the hospital's appointment. So we were saying to people in Darlington and in the boroughs of Darlington, if you've got time to spare, contact us, Age UK in Darlington, on 362 832 and we'll put you in touch with somebody you can help.
And quite a few people have done that, haven't they?
Have,
how many?
Well, I said just short of 600. Just short of 600.
So are you surprised by that number?
Yes, we are. Pleasantly surprised. Our actual objective is for 1,000 within 12 months. So we're getting there. And we could actually do with a few more referrals as well.
All right, let's go back to Kate Joplin, Director of the Campaign to End Loneliness. Are we fighting a losing battle then with buses? It doesn't look like they're going to come back anytime soon.
I really hope we're not fighting a losing battle on any of these issues, because I think that, you know, we have an ageing population in this country, and to continue to neglect the needs of older people is absolutely madness. However, we know that what ultimately cures loneliness is solutions that respond to the individual, because loneliness is about my experience. And so for some people, it will be about a bus to get to X or Y place. Some people want something much more personal, much more individual. They will want somebody who speaks to them on the phone. So I think we need to look at the whole range of solutions. And also, I think really importantly, we need to recognise that for some people, loneliness is an experience that's only in later life. For some people, it's a lifelong experience.
Now, we've heard from students this week. Is anybody surprised by that?
No.
No?
No, not really. Children are the same as adults. They become isolated. If they're not part of the crowd, they're on the outside. And it's happened for as long as I've been alive.
Yeah, we're hearing from students this week, John. You know, when you go to university, you're going away from home for the first time. Unless you put the effort in during Freshers Week to build up those relationships early on, you're a bit stuffed.
Indeed. I mean, it's your first time away from home. You've got no idea how things work. You've got no idea how the social networks connected to your residence or the residence or your university. So it can be a really difficult time for lots of young people.
We're talking about loneliness. It may surprise you to hear that we've got a big problem with loneliness in this part of the world, when we're also the friendliest place in the UK as well. If you want to comment, then we're taking your calls now, 01642 225511. If you'd rather text, that's no problem. 81333. Start your message with the word tease. That way it comes through to the right radio station. We'll do more talk about loneliness after the news at 11.
Yorkshire.
Proud of where we live. BBC Tees.
On 95 FM, on digital radio and online, this is BBC Tees. It's 11 o'clock and here's Lisa McCormick.
The big six energy suppliers are to face a full-scale investigation by the new Competition and Markets Authority. The energy regulator Ofgem says recent price rises and profit increases have intensified public distrust of the companies. The chief executive of Centrica, which owns British Gas, Sam Laidlaw, denied suggestions that the energy market was fundamentally flawed, but he says the two-year inquiry could delay decisions on future investment.
There is an increasing risk. I think a lot can be done in terms of demand management, but actually building new gas-fired power stations does take 4 years, and you know that's the time pressure that we're now up against, in that, you know, we've added another 2 years to this, so it's potentially going to be 6 years.
A report into how police forces deal with domestic violence has praised the work of Durham Police, but says there are areas for improvement for both Cleveland and North Yorkshire. A Majesty's Inspectorate of Constabularies has found North Yorkshire's initial response to be good, but says not all victims may receive future support they need. The report also says there are several areas of improvement for Cleveland Police before people can have a confidence that it's providing a consistently good service. Middlesbrough's to pioneer a genetic testing programme which could identify younger people at risk of heart attack. The town's become one of the first to secure funding to roll out the programme. It comes as BBC Tees is told that some people in their 20s are suffering heart attacks across the region. Dr Nigel Rowell is a Middlesbrough GP.
The trouble, I think, with managing 20 and 30-year-olds is, you know, at 25 you still think you're immortal and you can be told you have a bad heart age. And, you know, they know themselves if they've lost their dad at 45 and their gran at 55. And, you know, you don't need to be Einstein to work out you're at high risk, but at 25 you still feel immortal.
The Malaysian authorities say they're engaged in a race against time to find the flight recorder from an airliner which is presumed to have crashed in the Indian Ocean on the 8th of March. Efforts are continuing to determine whether debris in the sea hundreds of miles from Western Australia has come from the aircraft. England's chief medical officer has said she's increasingly concerned that people consider being overweight as normal. Professor Dame Sally Davis says that in a short period of time, there's been a profound change in the health of the nation. Almost two-thirds of adults and one-third of children are now overweight or obese. Local authorities are to investigate allegations that Jimmy Savile abused children at schools and care homes in his home city of Leeds in London and at locations in many places across England. It's understood the decision's been taken in response to an anonymous letter setting out claims about the presenter's conduct. Ministers say taxpayers will benefit from a decision to cancel a contract with the French company Atos that assesses whether disabled people are fit to work. Some disabled people have criticised Atos for the way it carries out the work and for delays. And the lower jawbone from a 45-foot whale, which beached at Redcar, is going in display in the town. The whale died after becoming stranded in 2011, but it's hoped the bones will provide a lasting reminder of the mammal. It's due to be unveiled today at the Zetland Lifeboat Museum. To sport, and Albert Adoma says Danny Graham's doing a great job for Middlesbrough despite struggling to find the back of the net. Graham scored just two goals, both against Ipswich, since joining Borough on loan from Sunderland at the end of January. Promoter Francis Warren's told BBC T Sport there's no chance of Stuart Hall featuring on the undercard of Carl Froch and George Groves in a world title fight at Wembley in May. Hall defends his IBF world bantamweight title against Martin Ward this weekend. And the Redcar Bears get the new Speedway season underway tonight in the first leg of the Tees Tweed Trophy. They'll take on Berwick Bandits at South Tees Motorsport Park. And with your weather this morning, here's Jen Bartram.
Turning cloudy as we head towards this afternoon with some heavy showers blown in on that brisk easterly breeze. Feeling very chilly with temperatures up to a high of 7 Celsius. That's 45 Fahrenheit.
Mike Parr, weekday mornings from 9.
And good morning. We're having an open and honest conversation about loneliness. We've done quite a bit of this on the BBC Tees this week. At the moment, we're just looking out through the window of BBC Tees reception. The weather isn't too good at the moment. It's tanking it down in the centre of Middlesbrough at the moment. If you're on your own or you have experienced loneliness in any form and you feel able to talk to us this morning, do get in touch. 01642 225511. If you prefer to text, it's 81333 and start your message with the word Tees.
If you're talking about it, we're talking about it. BBC Tees.
You're my sun, my moon.
That's Barry White. You're my first, my last, my everything. We're talking about loneliness this morning. Before we go any further, let me just read you this. This has come in from Shirley in Billingham. Shirley says, I'm a widow. I don't go anywhere special. I just go to church and a ladies' club every week. I use clubs, but as soon as you start going, they close down. I think there should be more centres which hold events like tea dances. Now, one of the big worries about loneliness is that it literally makes people ill. New research from Chicago University shows loneliness has a bigger impact on your chance of dying prematurely than obesity. Professor John Cacioppo has carried out a study.
The fact that it's twice as big a risk factor as obesity, that's actually from a meta-analysis done by a group at Brigham Young University, where they looked at a number of different risk factors, and they found social relationships or not having these connections more than doubled your odds of mortality over obesity.
Should health bodies then, local authorities, be part of this solution? We've got representatives this morning from Redcar and Cleveland Council and Durham County Council. But first, Edward Kunonga is the Director of Public Health in Middlesbrough and says loneliness should be treated as a social problem rather than a health one.
It's not easy, but we need to do the best we can to make sure that we provide opportunities for people to be more socially engaged. I think one of the ways that we're looking at is moving away from medicalizing the issue and approaching it more from a social point of view, where we recognize that within Middlesbrough we have a range of community assets. So we've got a number of community groups, we've got fantastic parks in the town, we are within driving distance of the countryside, of the seaside. There's walking groups, there's reading groups, and what we're saying is there's a diversity of things that can engage with people, and the challenge is how do we connect those groups. We're working very closely with the voluntary and community sector, who have got a stronger community presence, to make sure that we encourage people to look out for one another, bringing back the community spirit. Neighbors looking out for each other. There's a number of befriending schemes that we are also promoting across the town, so that we can identify sort of people with the who are lonely or who are socially isolated and connect them with the various things which I've already mentioned that exist across the town.
Well, let's talk to Sheila Clark, who's with us in BBC T's reception. Sheila is Cabinet Member for Health and Wellbeing from Redcar and Cleveland Council. Sheila, is he right?
Well, all I can say is loneliness and isolation is at the very heart of all our health agenda programmes. I believe that loneliness and isolation causes the health problems or is an underlying factor to all the health problems. Solve that and you will not get some of the health problems and you will be able to address the others as well. So I think loneliness and isolation is something that we need really to solve alongside other health problems, not put it apart from them. But I do feel that it's getting people out into activities. And if you, it's money, money, money. If you want to provide those activities, you've still got to help to fund and support people who do them, even where there is volunteering. And in 1997, there were 4 million people on the dole. The government had to move the money, funding for education to vocational qualifications. That meant that a whole range of non-vocational qualifications, things like carpentry, sewing, cooking, learning languages, history, just doing things for an interest, they all disappeared. Now we need to get those back. We need the funding and we need a huge social enterprise to get those back.
Kate Joplin from the Campaign to End Loneliness, you're nodding.
I am, because I think it's vital that we have a whole range of things available in our communities. And we recognise that actually investing in them is going to bring us savings in a whole range of budgets, not just our health budget, in our social care budget, across the piece. And I think, you know, when we can get this through people's brains and we can start to look at actually what we want to achieve in our communities, then I think we will start to see the investment shift. And it's really fantastic when councillors get this. It makes me really pleased to hear. But there's a lot more to be done to see that across the piece.
Heather Black is here from Together Middlesbrough. This is very much your thing, isn't it?
Yeah, I mean, what I want to say actually is that at the heart of loneliness is relationships. That is the solution. That if we feel that we have meaningful relationships that actually help us to know that we matter and that we cared for, it goes back, I suppose, because I represent a church group, love your neighbour as yourself. It's about encouraging good neighbourliness. And we've heard from some programmes today that are actually about that. So it's local people in communities making a contribution to do that. And the Silver Talk and the Good Friends schemes are fantastic examples of that, and we need to encourage and see more of that grow.
Susan Carter.
A very quick example of a lady in her 90s, very lonely and isolated, and she'd become very, very depressed. She was matched up with one of our volunteers, and this lady was in and out of hospital once a week, four times a month, and we actually managed to keep her out of hospital for 6 months, and we got a letter from the community matron congratulating us on the difference in her health and well-being and mental health, but also we actually saved the NHS £4,500 because this lady no longer dwelt on her illness and how she was feeling, because she was looking forward to the next visit from her befriender.
So it's all about relationships. So if those relationships are missing, or if your confidence is lacking, therefore you might have trouble forming relationships, you're going to have a bigger problem, John, aren't you?
Indeed. I mean, a lot of our older people that we talk to are older people, so their 70s, 80s, 90s. Some of those people have lost a little bit of their social confidence. They've been alone for a long time. So it takes a while to get your confidence back. We did, we had Professor Mima Catton from Northumbria University evaluate our service. And when they did the core data collection, what we discovered to our horror was that two-thirds of the older people we talked to had high and severe levels of depression. You know, that's a really worrying level of depression, and that was completely hidden. Nobody was aware that that was there until we started to do that research. You know, if you multiply that across the nation, that's a lot of people.
It's not just older people, though. We've mentioned students. There is a group that we haven't yet talked about. We'll talk about them next. It's 11:15. And it's Greg with your travel update.
Good morning. If you're heading out onto the main route, surround Middlesbrough, everything's looking okay so far. The A66 is fine. The same goes for the stretch of the A66 as you head over the Pennines. Traffic on the A1M also coping quite well. Apart from that, everything also looking well on the A19 on the traffic sensors so far this morning. If you're out and about in Darlington on Northgate, roadworks are underway still during the daytime near to the Commercial Street junction. Do expect a few delays while the work is underway there, and also some work at Towlaw on the A68 with temporary traffic lights in use. I'll be back with more in half an hour. If you can update me in the meantime, do give me a call on 0800 854 833.
Keeping Teesside, County Durham and North Yorkshire
on the move.
BBC Tees. It's history in the making. For the first time, two North East legends are going toe-to-toe for the headline challenge. In the Northern Echoes corner, editor Peter Barron's mother, Mrs. Barron. And in the BBC Tees corner, Ali Brownlee's mam, Mrs. Brownlee, in a unique headline challenge ahead of Mother's Day.
Yeah, but my mum loves me and your mum prefers me. So I think I'll be able to get it.
Seconds out. The build-up starts tomorrow from 6 on BBC Tees.
Welcome back to BBC Tees Reception. We're talking about loneliness. There's one group of people that we haven't talked about yet, single mums. How big of a, much of a problem is it for single mums then, Kate?
Well, we know that in the life course, we see two spikes of loneliness that tend to be around early adulthood and later adulthood. And that early adulthood spike, I think, is associated with some of the problems about moving away, but also at a time when a lot of people become parents. And in particular, if you're a single parent, it can be a really, really isolating experience. Suddenly your life has changed, your networks aren't there, and you've got to find a new way of being, and it can be extremely isolating and lonely.
What about other mums, though? Don't they support each other?
And they can be a huge support to one another, but for very many single mums, it can be very hard to find those groups. You have to have a bit of confidence to walk through the door in a mum and baby group, and some people need an extra bit of support to get through those doors.
I think that's right. And I mean, I remember moving to Middlesbrough with a toddler and a baby. I didn't know anybody, and that was isolating. So I went to a parent and toddler group, but everybody seemed to know each other, and it was quite difficult to actually have the courage to do that. So those groups are really important, but you also need older people involved in those groups who've been through that time to sort of say it's okay to admit that it's difficult and offer that support as well.
I put single mothers and young mothers, even with partners, in the same category as young carers. And we found there was a lot of isolation and loneliness with young carers. And we work in partnership with the Junction at Redcar, and they support young carers, as well as Mind and Carers Together. So you do need a tremendous amount of support. But for young carers, it's a particular problem as well.
We are beginning to run out of time on this. So as we approach the end of this discussion, I want to just get a feeling from you whether we're putting too much pressure on charities and voluntary organisations to come up with the solution to the problem.
Well, I think if charitable organisations like our own and others, if we didn't, what would then happen to the people that we're helping? Because
could we put more pressure on councils to do? There simply isn't the money, I suppose.
There isn't the money. I wish there was. And we're looking at other organisations to actually fund the projects that we actually do. I mean, in Darlington, the Darlington Partnership has funded the Good Friends Scheme for Age UK Darlington, for example, and we're really grateful about that. There are five organisations that are chipping in to make sure it continues for yet another year. But as far as organising, should somebody come in and do it? We do it. We love doing it. Who's going to do it if we don't?
The key is working in partnership with the charities and the community groups. There isn't the money, but if the local authority has a real interest in working with community groups and delivering this, we can. It's working differently.
The way around it for us is kind of working from a social housing provider, from a housing association, they are supporting our work, so bearing a chunk of the cost, and we're going out to other housing providers to seek a contribution so that we can roll it out across the UK. We've done Liverpool, set Liverpool off a couple of weeks ago. We're talking to Cheshire, we're talking to Yorkshire and Devon. So housing associations can actually put some money in, save themselves some money in the long run, and actually share the burden finance-wise.
I mean, it's absolutely right that the solution comes from communities, and who knows communities well, community organisations. So it's absolutely right that they should be in the forefront. But when we're seeing savings to the health budget, when we're seeing savings to social care, when we're seeing savings to housing, we need to make sure that money we're saving goes back to support those community organisations, because life is tough out there and they need sustainable funding and they need proper support to make sure that they can do that good work going forward.
All right, just finally, I'm going to go round the room. I'm going to get two things from you, if this is possible. First of all, I want some advice to somebody who is lonely. And secondly, what is the one thing you would wish for that might help the problem? So who wants to go first on that? What advice would you give? Pat?
Well, personally, I would say don't sit at home. Get up, go out, meet people. It's the only solution. If you don't, you will always be lonely. Always.
And then we as councils have to follow on from that, and we have to work to take our society back a little bit, one aspect of it, to where it was 50 years ago when people supported each other and not in a formal way. And that's what we are doing, working with the charities and groups and getting people to work to help each other, and as you say, friendships with each other.
I think if you're listening to this programme and you are feeling lonely and isolated, or you just want a little bit of help, if you just pick up the phone and ring Age UK Darlington on 01325 362 832, we'll do everything that we can to help you.
I would say have a look around, find your local volunteer centre, find your local Council for Voluntary Service. Both of those are kind of organisations that are really rooted in the community and can help you find groups, find activities that you might want to do, rather than being a recipient of something, be part of something, you know?
I would say isolation and loneliness is all of our problems, actually, and we all have a part to play. So I think everybody listening, thinking about what you can do. If you're feeling lonely, you can reach out to somebody else who's feeling lonely as well, because I think people all experience loneliness at some part in their lives.
Absolutely, and I think the really important thing to say, there's a huge stigma around loneliness, and, you know, just talking today, it should be really clear there shouldn't be. So don't feel ashamed. You are not lonely because of something you did. It's a circumstance that can affect anyone, and don't feel ashamed to reach out. But also, I would say, you know, longer term, we need to recognise that this is such an underlying cause. We've all talked about it today. It's an underlying cause of so many problems, and we need to take it seriously. Up there with obesity, we all think that that's a big problem that needs to be tackled. Loneliness should be even more so.
Some sobering thoughts there. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you very much indeed. 24 minutes past 11.